myself, Sikala Itayer from Malawi and representing the Partnership on Maternal, Newborn and Child Health. And here with me, as you can see, we are young women in the panel. Dynamic young woman in the panel who will be sharing a lot of their experiences also. I hope you're looking forward to that. So let's get right into it. To start off, I would want you to know who I am sitting with in our panel. Let's start off with Tiana.
Hi, welcome. I'm very excited to be here with all of you and join with my fellow panelists to talk a little bit about our advocacy experiences. So my name is Tiana. I am an advocate for social development because I believe that passivity is the antithesis to social change. And so I'm involved in quite a few different initiatives. One of those is with the Ontario Council for International Cooperation. So alongside five other global change makers, we are trying to make it easier for young advocates to get involved. So right now we're working on a toolkit for youth advocates, and we've identified kind of three different ways where youth can get involved, and one of those is by learning. So learning about causes that they're interested in, linking, so mobilizing other youth to get involved, and leading, so leveraging their position to be able to have an influence over decisions. And so I just wanted to kind of add that in there because our toolkit will be ready at the end of the summer. So I implore you all to check out the Ontario Council of International Cooperation website in a few months to have a look at that toolkit.
Thank you so much, Tiana. So that's Tiana. Let's move on to hear from Danite. She's also a young woman doing incredible work. Danite, tell us a bit more who you are, what do you do, the work that you're doing.
Yes. So hi, everyone. Can you hear me okay? So I'm Danite Mehertab. For those of you who've never heard that name before, that is a name of Eritrean origin. I'm Eritrean. I'm part of the diaspora here in Canada. I would like to, before I start introducing myself, like to take a second to acknowledge the land that we're on. We're on traditional unceded Algonquin territory, and I want to say thank you because I'm a guest on this land as a settler, and I benefit from a lot of privilege in that way. And so just taking a moment to sit with that and recognize that it's a blessing to be in this space and to be able to converge in this way. So as far as my work goes, I am part of Results Canada. I'm the Youth Community Engagement Officer. So that means I work with campus groups and young people to teach them about how advocacy is really cool. I mobilize them and we just really work to eradicate global poverty by making sure that our voices are heard within the democratic process. And I also, I'm wearing two hats. I am also a co-founder and the director of public relations for the Young Leaders Advisory Council, a group that is relatively new, a nonprofit, and we work to mobilize and support young marginalized youth in the nation's capital to be involved civically.
All right, great. Thank you, Danite. We're looking forward to hearing more of your experience of the work you've just shared as well. Moving on to my right, we have this lovely young woman, Zila. She's from Peru. But next to her, before we just give her an opportunity to share what she's doing and the work she's involved in, next to her we have Marlon, who is the translator here. But she's the director of international programs in Canada from Save the Children. And actually, the work and the organization where Zila is from is actually their local partner. So just to see the connection and the support and the partnership here. So Zila, over to you to just share the work that you do and who you are.
Yeah. Mi nombre es Zila.
My name is Zila.
Tengo 17 años.
I'm 17 years of age.
Soy de la región de Huánuco, Perú.
I'm from the Huánuco region in Peru.
Actualmente estoy estudiando sociología.
Right now I'm studying sociology.
Tengo el cargo de vicepresidenta en la organización de adolescentes, niños y niñas. Yo también tengo algo que decir.
So I'm the vice president of the organization that I'm here representing. We too have something to say, which is a children and youth organization from my region.
Nosotros como organización lo que hacemos es velar por dos derechos importantes.
As an organization, we are trying to protect two important rights.
que es el derecho a la participación,
the right to participation,
y el derecho a la protección contra todo tipo de violencia enfocados en lo que es violencia sexual,
and the right to protection from all types of violence, especially sexual violence.
Claro, porque esto es un problema que es muy en alto porcentaje.
This is a really big problem in the community where I live. There's a high percentage of violence.
En nuestro país y en nuestra región, enfocados en Huánuco.
Okay.
Ya. Yeah. Nuestra organización ha tenido reuniones con autoridades.
Our organization has had many meetings with local authorities.
Como podemos ver, todos son niñas, niños y adolescentes.
As you can see, all the representatives are young men and women.
Que desarrollamos nuestra ciudadanía haciendo incidencia.
So we basically enact our right to be citizens by carrying out advocacy activities.
Y esto es todo mi grupo de organización.
And these are all the representatives of my local organization.
Gracias.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Zila. I want to try pronounce that. So they're from an organization. This is how it's pronounced. Yo también tengo algo que decir, which actually stands for I too have something to say. So that is the power of young people and amplifying the voices of young people. And you know, this conference has started off about saying young people need to be empowered, they need to be engaged, they need to be informed in transforming this agenda where we talk about adolescent health and well-being. And here in our session, you have the opportunity to hear from us, to hear from them, and to hear their experiences, the strategies they've been using, and trying to see and find a way of what can you learn from them, how can you work with them. So let's get this discussion rolling. Starting with Tiana and Zila, we would like to hear from you. Let's start with you, Tiana. Perhaps you can share with everyone else, you know, the strategies that you've been using and the different youth initiatives you've been embarking on, and what has been successful.
Well, I think that one of the biggest challenges when engaging youth is continued engagement. So I think that as most human beings, when we see an issue that we connect with, we have an inherent propensity to want to get involved and we want to act without necessarily acknowledging the greater implications, meaning, you know, the time commitment that it takes, meaning the skills and resources that it might take, meaning that, you know, the obstacles that are going to come into our path. And I'm sure that, you know, all of us advocates out there know that there are a lot of obstacles, and sometimes it's difficult to kind of measure or see the incremental changes that we are making. And so I think that a lot of youth get involved with actions without necessarily realizing that it's not a clear path. There's not a, you know, a clear and simple way to engage. So one of the strategies that I've taken in my work is by acknowledging this kind of downfall and acknowledging that there are different levels of engagement and different ways that youth can connect with an issue. You know, there are some advocates that are going to schedule and coordinate meetings with MPs. There are some advocates that are going to be writing opinion letters or doing independent research. And then there are others that are going to get involved by tweeting on the issues or, you know, sharing, talking about these issues with their peers and sharing that way. And I feel like every single advocate, no matter what level they're involved with, is important and plays a role in advancing the agenda, the social agenda. And so one of the ways that I used kind of this knowledge or this strategy was last year I coordinated the 2016 Change the World program. And so that's a program that aims to engage youth, so ages 14 to 18, province-wide in Ontario, in their communities. And so what we did for the first time since its inception in 9 years, we surpassed our target. So we were able to engage 18,000 youth during a 6-week period.
Wow, 18,000 youth.
Yeah, and that's just in Ottawa, during a 6-week period. And they volunteered over 130,000 hours. And this is during school time, youth taking time. Yeah, it was amazing. They took time out of, you know, out of their days, out of their lives to give back to the community and engage with various causes. And so one of the reasons why this was so successful was because we acknowledged that, you know, these youth and these advocates were a heterogeneous group. They weren't all going to engage in the same way. So we had, you know, a youth advisory committee, and they were a little bit more high level. They were involved in leadership and decision making. And then we had school ambassadors, and they were kind of representatives and spokespersons for their own schools and kind of had a medium level of responsibility. And then we had just students who, you know, were able to engage and advocate with issues, you know, at a lower level of responsibility, yeah. but still give back and, mm-hmm. you know, and give to these causes. And I think that's important. It's important to have different levels and different ways that youth can engage with, yeah, with an issue.
Yeah. Tiana, just tell us a bit more on that. So you actually had reached young people within the school, so you actually were, you know, recruiting young people to be part of this. Would you go through the schools and be like, we were looking for young people to be involved in this, or was it a moment where you had something online or young people were signing up? How exactly did you get young people involved?
Yeah. Yeah. So that's just kind of to add on to the previous point, we did it on all levels. So yeah. we acknowledged that in order to be inclusive and to be accessible, we had to be able to access youth mm-hmm. at all levels. Mm-hmm. That meant having an online presence. That meant having a presence in the schools. Okay. That meant having, you know, leaders within the youth community that were able to kind of share with their networks mm-hmm. and, you know, having pamphlets out. That it, all levels, I think.
Yeah. No, that's great. Yeah. And you actually can see that from what she shared, you know, the power to reach where the young people are at, because, you know, a lot of people always say, oh no, we want to work with young people, but we don't know where they are and they're not coming out to actually share what they're doing. But you actually went out and reached out to where they were at and actually got them involved, and that is such a key strategy that you've shared. Moving on to Zilla, perhaps she can share, you know, with you know, the profile she gave us of the work they're doing, strategies they have used, and what has been successful.
Yeah, claro. Yo comenzaría diciendo que
I would start by saying that.
Yeah. Que nosotros primero como organización enfocamos en reunir niños y adolescentes de instituciones educativas.
So we basically pull together kids through the school system,
dándoles a conocer por medio de capacitaciones y talleres,
raising awareness through trainings and workshops,
sobre temas que nuestro estado quizá no toca o no enseña, no prioriza para los niños y adolescentes.
On issues that our state, our Peruvian state, doesn't prioritize for young people and that they should be aware of.
Nos preparan adultos de ONGs
yeah.
que nos priorizaron, como ya mencioné, en tema de derecho a la participación y derecho a la protección.
So we work with a local partner, adults that give us training for us to then go to the school to work with young people on issues of protection, particularly sexual violence and child participation.
Logrando el empoderamiento de cada adolescente para que ellos puedan así compartir el problema desde una realidad misma hacia las autoridades.
So with the objective of engaging young people in civic participation so that they can speak from their own place, through their own voice on issues that are relevant to them.
Porque hay algo clave que nosotros siempre decimos, que ellos pueden ver la realidad de una manera diferente a lo que nosotros mismos pasamos.
Yeah, because it's important, because we say amongst ourselves that it's important for each child or young person to speak with their own voice, because only they know their own reality. And, you know, even us as leaders of these workshops sometimes don't even have their perspective.
Mediante estas conversaciones con las autoridades, nosotros una de las propuestas que le planteamos es que la normativa del Estado que les exige que crean el Consejo Consultivo de Niños, Niñas y Adolescentes se implemente en mi región, que es Huánuco.
Okay. So what one of the main things that we were asking local authorities is the implementation of a local council for young people to have a space to be able to speak about these issues.
Ante tanta insistencia, se podría decir que nuestro gobierno lo implementó.
So after a lot of pressure and insistence from us, our local government actually put it in place.
Luego tuvimos otro logro que realizamos un debate electoral con los candidatos al Congreso.
So we also had another important achievement that we managed to get a debate with parliamentarians that were during elections to talk about some of these issues.
Donde tomen en cuenta los problemas que realmente aquejan a la niñez y adolescencia.
So that they can recognize the real problems that adolescent young people face.
Otro tema fue velar por la trata de personas y violencia sexual que afecta bastante en lo que es la salud en las adolescentes. So
another issue that was important for us that affects young women's health is the issue of trafficking and sexual violence.
Como por ejemplo teniendo prevención en las instituciones educativas cuando las alumnas salen del colegio, que nuestras autoridades velen para que ellas lleguen sanas a su hogar.
Right. So one of the issues they work with the schools, many of the young women going to school or, you know, leaving school were having issues with protection because they were, I think, estaban cerca de bares, cosas así, ¿cierto?
Sí.
Because sometimes the schools are located close to bars or discotheques, so there were issues the girls were facing going to school or leaving school. So they worked with the school and the local authorities to make them aware that they needed to pay attention to that.
Otro problema en mi región es que hay un lugar donde se ponen avisos de supuestos trabajos que son una captación de menores de edad para... ahí es donde se realiza la trata de personas con fines de explotación sexual. Y ese es lo que nosotros queríamos erradicar.
So another, finally, the last issue that we've worked with local authorities on is making them aware that because there's a trafficking problem in the area where I live, a lot of dubious advertisements were showing up, advertising for jobs for young people, attracting young people, and then, you know, capturing them into trafficking. So we've made local authorities aware that this was an issue as well.
Wow. Zila, how old are you?
Zila, ¿cuántos años tienes?
17 años.
I'm 17.
She's 17 years old. Wow. Never undermine the power of young people.
Then
with everything you've heard, What is your view? What can you add on? Maybe you have something else, any other experience you want to share. But with everything that's been said, what would you like to add on?
I think that there's really not much to add, but I think one piece that I really want to emphasize, it kind of goes on the, you talked about accessibility in outreach, and I think representation is also really important. In order to engage youth, we need to see ourselves represented in the spaces that you want us to engage in. I think it's important that we recognize our voices are more powerful when we're together. It's challenging sometimes when you're a token or when you are the representative for your group, and that's not the case. A success in my experience has been, a success in my experience has been working with other Black youth in Ottawa, and I think in that way we've been able to propel our vision farther together because we come at the vision from different intersections and from different experiences, and so we can collectively add to this idea and make it go farther than if one of us were just to be a representative in a space where there are none of us. So I think two really, really important things that I've heard along the way are nothing about us without us.
Exactly.
And for us, by us.
Yes. Wow. So Denied, with what you're saying, and I'm sure this is what a lot of people are picking up, the power of young people. And also the power of teamwork, because you know you can't do it on your own, as you've said. And I need to come back to Zila, because I feel like there's something that we all need to pick up from the strategies that she's been sharing as well. Because we've seen how, you know, they had been advocating and trying to voice out, and how they made breakthrough within decision-making processes within their own council in the country, which is really powerful. And maybe with you, Zila, you could share with us, why is it important, you know, to have young people as implementing partners when it comes to, you know, programming as well as advocacy?
Yeah. No, en mi país.
In my country.
Es un derecho, ya lo dije. Y entonces,
it's a right.
¿Por qué hacemos esto? Es porque estamos ejerciendo nuestro derecho
a la right participación. It's a right to be active and to engage.
Yeah. Nosotros, como, bueno, vuelvo a mencionar, nosotros conocemos nuestra realidad. Entonces, nosotros lo que hacemos es hacerles conocer el problema por donde estamos pasando a las autoridades y no solo decirles el problema que tenemos, sino que también le damos propuestas de solución para que ellos lo implementen en su gobierno.
Okay. So as I said, we know our reality best and what the issues are. And we go to local authorities and present the problems, but we also present or put forward solutions.
Yeah. Bueno, les cuento un poco. Yo comencé desde los 13 años cuando estaba en un colegio.
So let me tell you a little bit about how I started. I started when I was 13 through the school.
Y ahí fue donde me enseñaron a que yo debo ejercer mi participación haciendo incidencias sobre temas que a mí realmente me preocupan.
So there I learned that I should enact my civic responsibility to be a citizen and to speak up about issues that matter to me.
Porque creo que en mi país la mayoría de las personas viven enfocados simplemente en su vida y qué es lo que van a hacer más adelante para mantenerse nada más.
Okay, because in my country many people are just focused in basically, you know, being successful and just basically surviving, and they're not concerned about some of these other issues.
Y no se ponen a pensar en el tema de que qué estará pasando no la otra persona que vive a mi costado.
And they're not thinking about what's happening to the person that lives next to me.
No se ponen a pensar en las personas más vulnerables.
They don't think about those that are most vulnerable.
Que tienen menos oportunidades.
That have less opportunities.
Y entonces ahí es donde yo hago desarrollo mi labor como ciudadana para hacer incidencia en estos problemas y poder ayudar a las personas que menos tienen oportunidades.
So that's where I feel I have a responsibility to, you know, participate and speak up and give, you know, voice to the needs of those that are more vulnerable.
Porque yo tengo la idea de que soy ciudadana si hago incidencia.
Because my idea is that I'm a citizen if I advocate.
Y creo que así también somos inspiración para generaciones futuras, porque si de niños y de adolescentes aprendemos a ver realidades distintas, vamos a tener más, ¿cómo se dice? Más interés para poder ayudar y que ellos tengan las mismas oportunidades que yo tengo.
Yeah, and I think that we should be an inspiration for future generations by speaking up about these issues and, you know, making, you know, our societies aware that, you know, not everybody has the same opportunities.
Porque personalmente, en los hogares, los patrones culturales en mi región te enseñan que por ser mujer, por ser niña, tienes que ser más sumisa.
Because our cultural patterns in Peru are such that we're taught as girls that we have to be more submissive.
Cuando en realidad no es así. Si
when
tú
in
quieres,
reality it's not like that.
Si tú quieres hablar, simplemente exprésalo, ¿no?
Yeah, if you want to speak up, just speak up.
Zila, thank you so much. With what she said, I hear a hashtag, youth speak up. Young people speak up. Because you see that, you know, as young people, when they're empowered with the information and the skills, they have the power to actually advocate and speak up on their needs, on their rights. And I think that is a key thing that she spoke about civic engagement, understanding as young people what are our rights, and that we have the right to speak out about all the issues that affect us, right? Mm-hmm. Moving on to, I'm gonna come back to you, Tiana. We haven't forgotten about you, but we're going to bring it back to the night, and I'm going to come back to you to just also share your inputs and the discussions that are going on. The night, tell us, you know, with everything you've shared and your experience, what have been the barriers that young people face, social, systematic barriers, when it comes to access to health?
Yeah. So I'd like to address that when we talk about barriers, it's really important that we don't forget that there is systemic oppression at play. And that oftentimes denies Black, Indigenous, newcomer, first generation, diaspora, queer and trans, refugee, and youth with both invisible and visible disabilities, equitable access to healthcare and other resources. This lack of representation at the decision level, decision-making levels, is what directly impacts our lack of funds. A lot of our policies, a lot of Canada's policies, don't really reflect this inclusive and diverse Canada that we love to promote and talk about. And I think it's really important that we have this conversation, as uncomfortable as it may be, because how can we progress if we don't acknowledge these things? And so I'd like to quickly bring in an example, actually, of an Indigenous example of Attawapiskat. So in 2016, as I see a lot of nodding heads, so some of you might be familiar with the fact that, I'm also, if I'm misquoting, I apologize, but 11 people from the community of 2,000, young people, kids, age 10, 11, 13, tried to commit suicide in a pact. If that isn't a cry for help, I don't know what is. And this is, it's really alarming, because as I was researching this, Attawapiskat actually declared a state of emergency in October 2011, and nothing was done. And even though the Prime Minister tweeted, "The news from Attawapiskat is heartbreaking. We'll continue to work to improve living conditions for all Indigenous peoples," April 10th, 7:36 p.m. I think we have to question, what are we doing? A lot of us are celebrating 150, you know, Canada's 150. But what are we doing to ensure that these Indigenous communities are getting the resources that they need? They don't have, not all, I'm not gonna speak for all communities, but some of these communities don't have clean drinking water. They don't have the homes, and they're living in a state of deficit. And so how can we expect them to be able to thrive before they can even survive, right? And I think it's really, I highlight this because I think it's important that we bring this perspective in every platform and every conversation. And not to say that Indigenous communities aren't capable and incredible and resilient, because it's 150 years of resilience that we are seeing. But I think it's also important that we recognize the systemic barriers that are at play, or the systemic oppression and racism that's at play, and the genocide that's happening when we aren't giving these, our communities, yeah. You know, and it's not just Indigenous communities, it's Black communities too. It's refugees, refugee communities. It's people in indefinite detention, you know? And then the last thing that I would like to bring up is the fact that we don't necessarily always have the same ability to navigate the system, because it wasn't made for us. It wasn't made with us in mind. Mm-hmm. And so how do we reframe that, and how do we, for the next 150 years, make sure that we change this system?
Yeah. I think that's really, really important. And I think that applies on so many different levels, mm-hmm. is the importance of conversations, and having conversations about the systemic oppression, mm-hmm. and having conversations about racism, and just conversations about everything. Let's just talk. Yeah. I think that, you know, we need to be able to break stigmas that, you know, it's a taboo subject, or that we can't talk about it. And that applies to a lot of different things. So even if you think about, like, sexual health and the barriers that, mm-hmm. you know, lack of conversation, you know, imposes there, we need to be able to, you know, talk about menstruation, and talk about pregnancy, and talk about sexually transmitted diseases, so that we provide, you know, a safe and inclusive space for youth to, mm-hmm. to get informed about these things, and, yeah. you know, to be able to ask questions and to voice their concerns. And I think that lack of conversation, yeah. is a huge barrier.
Wow. Yeah. So with everything Dave said, hashtag let's talk. Hashtag let's change the system,
right?
Yeah. To ensure that young people are now involved in the different processes, because you talked about policies and the systems that have been barriers. So, you know, let's change the system. Let's look at that. Things need to be done differently, right? Zilla, back to you. With what you've shared and the amazing work that you're doing, I know as young people and with your peers that you're working with, there are always challenges that you're facing. Perhaps you could briefly share, you know, what challenges you face, and, you know, what support, you know, for young people do we need? What can we ask our partners, you know, right now, what support do we need?
Claro, ya lo escuchamos en la sala al decir que un esfuerzo individual no va a tener tanto valor como que cuando todos nos juntamos y hacemos una presión más fuerte.
Right. You've heard some of it already. I think coming together collectively, not working as individual, is an important means of achieving change.
Yeah. El desafío para mi organización personalmente es este.
The challenge for my organization personally.
Es el tema de sostenibilidad.
It's sustainability.
Porque como lo mencioné, nosotros somos informados, preparados en temas de conocer nuestros derechos y hacerlos valer.
Right. So we are educated or trained in terms of learning and, you know, about our rights. And working to validate and making them, those rights come to life.
Pero nosotros no sabemos la parte técnica de cómo llevarlo a cabo independientemente, por así decirlo.
Right, but we don't have the technical know-how, if you will, to know how to, be able to do workshops and organize workshops. So we need support.
Yo creo que para nosotros es importante, así como tenemos capacitaciones para conocer estos temas, también tendríamos algún tipo de capacitaciones para conocer la parte práctica y nosotros tener las iniciativas más fuertes y salir como organización adelante.
Right, just so that, just as much as we have trainings in terms of learning about our rights and, you know, all the awareness raising that is carried out through the schools, we also need some support in terms of the technical know-how. In terms of being independent, being able to organize workshops and work with young people.
Así que el tema del presupuesto es muy importante.
So the budget is very important.
Porque tristemente en mi país solo el 1% es destinado para protección y participación.
Because sadly in my country only 1% of the budget goes to participation and protection issues.
Y si nos centramos más, solo el 0.02% es para participación.
Yeah, and even if you go even more focused, 0.02% is actually focused, is budgeted for participation.
Entonces nuestro mismo gobierno no está fomentando la participación de nosotros para empoderarnos como líderes.
Right. So our government doesn't really encourage participation. You know, it doesn't really put resources behind empowering young people to be active citizens.
Otro desafío es el rol que ocupan las instituciones educativas, los colegios.
Another challenge is the role that schools play.
Porque nosotros como niños y adolescentes todavía no tenemos la capacidad abierta de ir y tomar nuestras propias decisiones porque detrás de nosotros están nuestros colegios y nuestros padres.
Right. So the role of the schools and the power dynamic between, you know, young people and educators and parents, they still, even though they're empowered with knowledge, they still don't have the full capacity to be able to take action in a lot of instances.
Y si nosotros no tenemos el apoyo de ellos, no vamos a poder surgir.
Right. So without the school support and parent support, we can't flourish.
Los colegios tienen que tomar más conciencia, los profesores.
Schools have to take more, be more conscious, particularly teachers.
Y nuestros padres
parents,
en apoyarnos, en ser un soporte para nosotros.
In being a support to us as young people.
Y nosotros así vamos a poder empoderarnos más y poder hablar más sobre los temas que nos aquejan.
Right, and that way we will be more empowered and be able to speak up about issues that are relevant for us.
Entonces, ¿cuál sería el apoyo que nosotros nos dan? Que la capacitación no solo sea para nosotros, sino que para también los docentes y para nuestros padres.
Right.
Para que ellos conozcan, ¿no?
Yeah. So training only targeted at young people without, you know, also including teachers and parents, yeah, is not as impactful because they need to act as a support system.
Oh, right. I'll come back to you, Zila. But I don't want to lose out everything and all the incredible things you're saying. But another hashtag, we need support, we need resources, we need knowledge, we need capacity building. And she said it all. And as all these things are coming out, and I hope everyone is taking time and actually thinking, what can I do to close this gap? We are running out of time because we want to hear from all the amazing people here in the room and the audience. So I'll come back to you just, you know, going forward. Denait and Tayana, perhaps you can say, you know, what support do young people need going forward? Tayana, you're free to add your last remarks to that as well. But let's start with you.
Yeah.
So like I said, I think we need representation, we need funding, we need to address and acknowledge the systemic racism barriers that prevent our communities from being able to thrive. And I think the biggest thing is we need to have people in positions of power to recognize that we don't need to be empowered. We're born with power inherently. We just need the platform and we need the resources, like Zilla said. So making sure that you're here to come and work with us from a place of partnership and solidarity, not from a place of, oh, they have not and I have.
I think that sums it up perfectly. I think that youth are an incredibly powerful resource. Mm-hmm. And with the right support and within the right context, I think that, you know, we do have the power to make an important change.
Yeah. Zilla, you have the last remark. What would you like to say?
Solo una pequeña cosa.
One little thing.
Que, bueno, es un problema resaltante de mi país. Que los patrones culturales que resaltan que la niña, o sea, una niña tiene menos oportunidades que un varón.
So, in my country, like as I said, the predominant cultural pattern, you know, basically puts girls at a disadvantage.
Entonces, el problema que yo creo que tenemos personalmente,
the problem that I feel that we have,
es que los patrones culturales en mi región se destruyan por completo.
That's my desire, that those cultural patterns be basically destroyed.
Así vamos a evitar que menos violencia sexual haya.
That way we will avoid or reduce the levels of sexual violence.
Que se fomente la participación ciudadana desde pequeños.
We will encourage child participation from a young age.
Y que vivamos en un país más sociable, ¿no?
Right, and that we will live in a country that is more social.
Porque tristemente nos falta eso todavía.
Because sadly that is still lacking in my country.
Y no sé, pedir a la cooperación canadiense que no invierta en nuestros gobiernos todo el presupuesto que tiene, sino en las organizaciones de niños y adolescentes, que ellos son el futuro, ¿no?
Right.
Desde ahí nos formamos.
And asking the Canadian cooperation not to invest all the money government to government, but actually to invest in local organizations, particularly organizations led by young people who are really keen on being actively engaged in changing the patterns of you know, the cultural patterns that basically oppress young women.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much, Zilla, and thank you so much to amazing, young, brilliant leaders taking action. And you've heard from them. And you know, some of these issues that they've been sharing, they're not new to all of us. We've been hearing this over and over and over. And now the question stems from, what are we doing? What are we going to do differently? Because what she shared is that nothing has changed, not only in her country, but in all of our countries. We're still facing the same issues these young people are sharing, but they're standing up and they're doing something. What are you going to do? And this is that opportunity where we're going to open up the floor. We don't have much time, but I'm looking for two key questions. But with your question, please also make a commitment, because we want you to move out of here taking action, because it's youth taking action. So please, with whatever question you have, also share what commitment you're going to take forward to change the certain challenges that have been shared today. So two questions and a commitment from the floor. We have one, they maybe can go to the mic. Any other?
Should I go to the mic? Or?
Yes.
Yeah.
Quisiera, pues, ya, muchas gracias. Quisiera realmente hacerte una pregunta directa, porque, bueno, yo soy indígena y también en algún momento, pues, contarte un poco el trabajo que estamos haciendo. Estamos trabajando con niñez y adolescencia, empoderamiento, la promoción y la protección de los derechos sexuales y reproductivos de niñez y adolescencia en comunidades indígenas. Mi pregunta directa es, porque me llama la atención cuando tú hablas de que se viven patrones dentro de la sociedad que no permiten como el acceso, la oportunidad a las niñas, que se les da más la oportunidad a los niños, entonces, o a los hombres. Entonces yo quisiera que tú me respondieras desde tu perspectiva como niñez y adolescencia, ¿de dónde se han adquirido esos patrones? ¿De dónde vienen?
Maybe you speak English. ¿Habla inglés o no?
No.
Okay.
Necesito, por favor, tu apoyo.
No entendí de qué organización eres.
Asociación Pies de Occidente.
Okay. So
Guatemala.
She's from Guatemala. She works for an indigenous organization that works on issues of adolescent sexual reproductive health, particularly of young women. And she's interested in hearing from her perspective, from Zila's perspective, what are the cultural patterns that oppress and put girls in this state of submission? Where do these patterns come from? That's the question.
Perú hay algo que predomina, así vamos a ser claros, es el machismo.
Right. So in Peru, what predominates is machismo.
Que se genera por un término de masculinidad hegemónica, donde al hombre se le impone que, bueno, al hombre mismo se le enseña que tiene que ejercer más poder sobre la mujer. Y creo que esto no solo se da en mi país, sino son en otros países diversos. Right. Y ahorita que te escucho, o sea, no solo me afecta a mí.
Right. Y so in Peru, predominantly there's this hegemonic kind of worldview of masculinity, where young boys are taught from a very young age that they need to be dominant over everyone else. Particularly women. And as I hear you, it sounds like it's not just an issue in Peru, but in other parts of the world as well.
Claro, y como hay una lucha constante de que nosotras como mujeres salgamos adelante, como mencionaste, en las partes indígenas, en las zonas rurales, aún hay esos patrones que tienen más poder, y eso es lo que nosotros queremos erradicar, ¿no?
Right. And it's a constant kind of power struggle, and it's particularly evident in rural areas, indigenous areas of Peru, where young women have a really hard time finding a space for themselves.
Para que todos tengamos oportunidades y hay equidad de género.
Right, so that all women can have gender equity and access to equal power.
Okay, great. Your commitment, quick, brief.
Tu compromiso es cuál?
¿Mi compromiso?
Sí.
Para erradicar mi compromiso como mujer, como indígena, es realmente fortalecer el trabajo para la niñez y adolescencia, para empoderarlas, para que puedan tomar decisiones autónomas en relación a su cuerpo.
Yeah, my commitment as a woman and as an indigenous woman is to work with organizations of young people to continue to empower them and to change these cultural patterns.
All right, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Unfortunately, I can only take one more question because I only said I can only take two. So, sadly, but they will be here, and after the session, you're welcome to just approach any of them and talk to them and hear from them and work with them and partner with them. So,
thank you all. Thank you all for sharing your experiences and your knowledge. I will lead up to my question to what was suggested. So we're seeing patterns. We're seeing patterns where young men are being educated from the young age of dominance. And I'm wondering if we could share some ideas about, at the ground level, how some of the boys and men that are involved in empowering the women, the girls, the boys, the men, towards gender equality. What kind of roles are they playing, and how are they supporting the transformation of gender equality? So, and my commitment is around my question.
Okay, great. I would like you haven't said much, but I would like to give Tiana, would you like to take that?
Sure. So I think that we can't have gender equality without the inclusion of boys and men. I think that that's a common misconception, and I think that the term feminist, for example, is a loaded term, right? And it people tend to shy away or get intimidated by that term. But I think it's extremely inclusive. I think that it just kind of advocates for equality of women, of men. And I think that it's about having, like we were saying, like those conversations and having men involved in those conversations and them being able to normalize this idea of feminism and normalize the idea that it's not just women working towards women, it's society, it's everybody working towards an inclusive and equal society. Does that kind of answer your question? See, I think that it's like what Danae was saying about representation. It's about being able to be kind of allies and being able to support a cause without coming at it from a kind of paternalistic and all-knowing way. I think that it's a great thing to have men involved in the causes and to kind of also understand their roles and understand that their experiences are different and they're coming at it from their own experiences and still supporting equality.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. So you've had actually young men involved in taking lead on your causes as well?
Absolutely, yeah.
Okay, great. So that's all. We've come to the end of the session, unfortunately. But like I said earlier on, hashtag, let's talk. Hashtag, what will you do about everything that has been spoken about today? Hashtag, youth take action. Thank you very much.